So let me thank the organizer for inviting me in this meeting. So today I am going to talk about finding X-ray in oxide heterostructures. So basically I will try to show that these oxide heterostructures can give you many emergent phases and how you can have understand this phenomena using various X-ray based techniques. So we already know about strongly correlated oxides. So one of the main aspects of strongly correlated oxides are there are strong intercoupling between the spin, charge, lattice and orbital degrees of freedom. As a result, they exhibit various kinds of fascinating electronic and magnetic phenomena like superconductivity, metal insulator transition, magnetism, etc. And the other important aspect is that these phenomena are highly tunable. Like for example, you can start with an antiferromagnetic insulating phase, then if you dope it, you will get some superconducting phase. So all of these different colors represent some other phase of the materials. So similarly, this is the phase diagram of V2O3 and this axis is pressure. So suppose you are here, so generally you think that if you apply pressure, the structure will change. But you see at this temperature, if you apply pressure, it will become from an antiferromagnet to a paramagnet. So that means there is a coupling between the spin and also the structure. So now with the advancement of thin film technologies, nowadays you can make heterostructures, means you can combine two, three different systems into the same systems with unit cell precision. And when you grow this kind of heterostructures, there are different way also you can tune the property. Like at the interface, you can have charge transfer, like you can apply compressive strain, you can apply tensile strain, you can apply magnetic field, and also you can do quantum confinement. Basically along the C direction, you can control the thickness of the material, and as a result, the electron will be forced to move only in two dimensions, and that can give rise to many new things. But in this talk, what I will focus that how the pure structural competition across the interface gives rise to new phenomena. So this is one of the most illustrative examples of oxide heterostructures and emergent phenomena. So like if you take a strontium titanate, which is a band insulator, the band gap is 3.2 eV and lanthanum aluminate, the band gap is 5.6 eV. If you grow this lanthanum aluminate on top of strontium titanate, it actually becomes a metal. So its resistivity as a function of temperature. So out of two insulators, you are getting one metal. Similarly, so this metallic phase also hosts many unusual phases like superconductivity, ferromagnetism, etc. So similarly, there are other examples also, like if you can get ferromagnetism out of two non-ferromagnetic components, like calcium manganate is a antiferromagnet and calcium ruthenate is a paramagnet, but if you grow heterostructures, they become ferromagnet. Similarly, this is another example. This cuprate is insulator and this is another cuprate. It's a metal, but if you grow heterostructures, it becomes superconducting. This is resistivity as a function of temperature. Recently, there are also reports that you can get topological Hall effect in strontium ruthenate, strontium iridate heterostructures. Okay. So these phenomena are interesting. Now the question is that how you can understand these phenomena microscopically, these kind of things. So I will try to convince you in next half an hour that various X-ray based techniques are very, very useful in order to understand these systems. So before that, let me just tell you briefly that how we are growing these materials. So the technique which are using is called pulse laser deposition. Many of you are familiar with it, but just sake of completeness, let me explain it very briefly. So in this technique, you have basically a very high energy laser. It falls on a material for which you want to grow the film. And because the energy is very high, these materials basically forms a plasma, and this plasma transfer the material from this target and it is deposited on top of this substrate. So apart from this basic PLD, we have also this additional setup which is known as reflection high energy electron diffraction or REED. So basically this is a very surface sensitive diffraction technique. So you can monitor during the growth that how your systems is evolving with time. Okay, so this is a diffraction pattern from this top of the substrate, and this spot which is 0, 0, that is called specular spot. And you can monitor this intensity of this specular spot as a function of time. So if you grow this material one layer at by like in that fashion, then you will get this oscillations. Suppose you have a perfect crystal, so you have a perfect diffraction and your intensity is quite high. Then when you start to deposit on top of that, so the atoms are coming and falling on the surface randomly. Yeah. So as a result, there will be lots of diffuse scattering and this intensity will drop down. Yeah. So after when it is more or less half covered, then this electron beam will diffract it from the top layer itself, and gradually this intensity will go up. And again, when it's perfect one layer, you will get back the intensity. So that's why you will get these oscillations in the reed, and by that you know that you can grow one layer at a time. So from here to here is basically one unit cell. So you can control in the limit of 4 angstrom. In that length scale, you can control. So this is some experimental data for one thin film on neodymium nickelate. You can see reed oscillations, and also this is an STM image. So to show the quality of the samples that you can grow. So basically, this is the substrate and this is the film. These big black spots, those are this neodymium, and these small ones are nickel this side, and this side is gallium. You can see at the interface there is no defect. So it's like very defect free systems. So now I will come back to the real system, what I'm trying to explain here. So this materials is called as rare earth nickelates. So as a function of temperature, and this is the temperature axis and this is the bond angle axis. So if you go here, the angles is less distorted, and if you move along this direction, the angles are more distorted. Okay. So these materials have been studied quite extensively in like in 2000, also in mid 2000s. But in 2008, there are reports that you can get superconductivity in these rare earth nickelates by heterostructuring. So the main idea was that if you count the d electron, this nickel has 7 d electron. That means you have one electron in the eg orbitals. So by heterostructuring, if you can lift the degeneracy of the system, then you will have a situation where you have a dx square minus y square orbital with one hole. That is same as the high TC cuprate. So that was the prediction. By that's why you can get superconductivity. So after that report, there are lots of work has been performed on these systems. So finally, in like 2 months ago, there are a report now that now you can see superconductivity in these systems. But I am not going to talk about that. The other important aspect is that this origin of this metal insulator transition. That because if you go along this line, there are 4 different transitions together. If you go along this line, there are 3 different transitions. So metal insulator transition always accompanied with a structural transition and also a charge ordering transition. Then how can we explain this thing? So this leads to a lot of work over the last 10 years. We wrote a review article couple of years ago, but in 2016, but after that also most of the understanding has also changed quite a bit. So in this talk, I will focus the interface between europium nickelate and lanthanum nickelate. So if you focus on europium nickelate, that the high temperature, it's a metal, it has orthorhombic structure and it's a paramagnet. If you cross this boundary line, it undergoes a metal to insulator transition, structure also becomes monoclinic, and also it becomes charge order. What is charge order? I will explain later. And if you lower the temperature further, it undergoes another additional magnetic transition from a paramagnetic insulating phase to an antiferromagnetic insulating phase. And if you look at lanthanum nickelate, which is sitting here, that has a rhombohedral structure and which is metal, it's a paramagnet, doesn't undergo any transition. Now, our idea was that if we grow heterostructures of these two materials, what will happen? The reason is the following. Now, if you look at the structures, they are actually distorted. Okay. So there is a formalism which is known as Glaser notation. By that, you actually describe how these octahedra are distorted. Now, if you look at lanthanum nickelate, if you look at along all the axes, you see these octahedra, two consecutive octahedra, they are rotated in the opposite direction. So that's why this is denoted by this minus sign. So it's A minus, A minus, A minus. So all are in out of phase. But if you look at europium nickelate, along A and B direction, they are also in out of phase, A minus, A minus. But along C direction, you are looking along C direction, you can see that all of these octahedra are rotated in the same direction. So this rotational phase is C plus. Yeah. So now you can see that if you grow these two materials on top of each other, then at the interface there will be frustration, structural frustration, because this material will try to invoke A minus rotational pattern, whereas this one will try to impose C plus. Yeah. So at the interface, we don't know what is going to happen. So that's why we are growing these systems like by varying the thickness of the material also. Like this is an 2 unit cell of europium nickelate and 1 unit cell of lanthanum nickelate. So this is one period, this blue and orange, and then we are repeating this thing many times. So similarly, we have also grown like one unit cell of europium nickelate, 1 unit cell of lanthanum nickelate, and this is 1 unit cell of europium and 2 unit cell of lanthanum. So for the time being, you can forget about the substrate. Substrate is same in every cases, it's neodymium gallate. So while we grew these materials, we see something interesting, that apart from this specular and off-specular spot, which I already explained you, so in these two systems, we can see some additional diffraction in the read, indicated by white arrow. Okay, so these are basically half-order peak. This half-order peak generally you can see for orthorhombic symmetry or monoclinic symmetry, because along one direction, your periodicity is double in the real space. So anything double in real space means in the reciprocal space, you have half. That's why you see this half-order peak. So similarly, this, but in this case, we don't see that thing. So this tells us that these two systems are either orthorhombic or monoclinic, while this system is rhombohedral. You can see that by just changing one unit cell, you can change the symmetry of your system. So, but we have to remember this read is very surface sensitive technique. Yeah. So we need to confirm that whether this change of symmetry is related to your bulk property or is just the surface. So in order to check that, we have done synchrotron X-ray diffraction experiment. So now this orthorhombic and monoclinic symmetry, this octahedral rotation A minus C plus, that also drives an antiparallel displacement of these A sides, these nickel sides. You can see these yellow spheres, they are moving in this direction, and this layer, they are moving in the opposite direction. You can see both things, this thing in both in orthorhombic symmetry and monoclinic symmetry. But if you look at rhombohedral structure, you don't see this displacement. Okay. So this displacement, if you do, you have, then you in the diffraction, you get certain kinds of specific diffraction spot. This is like 0, half 2. Okay. So you can see in both cases, you see both substrate peak and film peak, because substrate is also orthorhombic. Yeah. So this tells us that these two systems, 2-1 and 1-2, both of them are orthorhombic or monoclinic. Yeah? We cannot distinguish by this. Whereas this system 1-2, which read suggests is rhombohedral, is actually rhombohedral. You can see the peak from the substrate, but not from the film. So using this read and synchrotron X-ray diffraction, we can say that the symmetry is basically of this thing is either on orthorhombic or monoclinic, and this is rhombohedral. So in order to further distinguish whether it's orthorhombic or monoclinic, we have done more measurement. So this is another diffraction minus half-half, which is allowed in monoclinic symmetry but forbidden in orthorhombic symmetry. You can see a film peak. Yeah, so that tells us that it is monoclinic. Yeah? So that's because neodymium gallate is orthorhombic, that's why you don't see the substrate peak here. So from this, we can conclude that these two systems at room temperature is monoclinic, and this is rhombohedral at room temperature. Now, if you go back to this phase diagram, you see whenever you have a monoclinic phase, you expect that system to behave like an insulator. So this is a monoclinic phase, this is a monoclinic phase, both are insulator, and this orthorhombic is metal. So from this bulk phase diagram, you can expect that these two systems will be insulating at room temperature, and this 1-2, that system should be metal in the room temperature, at the room temperature. So this is what you see in the experiment. This is the resistivity as a function of temperature. So this, you can see in both cases at 300 Kelvin, they are basically metal. They doesn't follow, they do not follow the bulk phase diagram. So this, and also they undergo metal insulator transition. So this is for cooling run and this is for heating run. So that means there is basically a strong thermal hysteresis between heating and cooling curve. So these two systems undergo a first order metal insulator transition, and this systems undergo, it remains metal down to 2 Kelvin at least. So the other important part is that in this part of this system, so down to 250 Kelvin for this system and down to 150 Kelvin for this system, you get a monoclinic metal phase, which is not there in this phase diagram. So that's a basically an emergent phase, which is coming because of the heterostructuring. Okay, so now let us see that how we can probe the antiferromagnetic ordering of these systems. So this rare earth nickelate, so original experiment was done on powder sample using neutron diffraction. And this is the magnetic cell which was derived from neutron diffraction result. So basically you can see that you need 4 structural unit cell to get 1 magnetic unit cell. So it's basically, you can see that in one plane it is up, then this is rotated by 90 degree, another 90 degree, another 90 degree, and then you get the repetition. So, but this neutron diffraction is not effective for thin film samples because our samples are typically 10 nanometer thin. Yeah? So, neutron diffraction is not possible to do. So in order to do that, we rely on another technique, which is known as resonant soft X-ray scattering. So basically, it's a mix, it's a hybrid techniques of diffraction and X-ray absorption spectroscopy. So what you look in this experiment, that you tune the energy to this energy 852.7 eV, that's basically a resonance energy of nickel. So at this energy, electron from nickel 2p level will be excited to nickel 3d level. And from Newton diffraction, you already know that this is your magnetic wave vector, half zero, half, or in pseudo cubic notation is quarter, quarter, quarter. Because this is repeated 4 times in the real space, so that means in momentum space is 1/4, 1/4, 1/4. Yeah? So in this diffraction, in synchro, this soft X-ray scattering, you look for this peak and then you investigate the temperature dependence. That is what you have to do. So this is for these 2-1 samples. You can see that at low temperature, you can get this diffraction peak. And as you increase the temperature, this intensity drops down. And if you plot the intensity as a function of temperature, this is basically the area under the curve. You can see that it undergoes a antiferromagnetic to paramagnetic transition around 220 Kelvin. And the metal insulator transition temperature is 245 Kelvin. So they are separated. And if you look at the other samples, 1-1, both of that sample undergoes simultaneous metal insulator transitions and also magnetic transition. Okay. So after that, then we need to see what happens to the charge ordering. What is charge ordering? Since in the bulk nickelates, this insulating phase is monoclinic, so nickels are inequivalent. Yeah. So the idea was that basically this metal insulator transition is a charge disproportionation transition, like D7 plus D7, it goes to D7 plus delta and D7 minus delta, and they arrange in an alternating fashion. So this was the earlier proposals, and also there are experimental reports to support this thing. But in recent times, the theory tells some other picture, which is known as called bond ordering. So though ionically these nickelates are D7, but they are actually negative charge transfer materials. So you have lots of holes on the ligand. So in the ground state is basically not D7, but it's more like a D8 L bar. By L bar, I mean there are lots of holes on the oxygen. And this transition, thus metal insulator transition, is basically this. Like you have a D8 L bar and D8 L bar, and these holes on the oxygen that moves and it becomes D8 and D8 L2 bar. So if you consider the charge, in both cases, the charges are same, it's D8. So it's not a formal charge ordering. But this nickel D8, that has this nickel oxygen bonds, those are extended. And for these cases, these bonds are much more shorter. So that's why it's called a bond disproportionation transition. And also this D8 state is a S equals to 1 state, and D8 L2 bar, that is a S equals to 0 state. However, you can see that basically what ultimately this picture will be very similar, because if you increase this bond disproportionation, you should get back this thing. Yeah, that is also actually you can see from cluster calculation. So in this paper, it is this bond disproportionation that is varied as for different amount, and this is the nickel occupancy as a function of this delta D. You can see that when this delta D is 0, this occupancy is exactly same, D8, but as you are increasing this thing, these two things are getting separated. So that means this charge order and bond order, basically they are cooperating in nature in bulk system. Okay, so this charge ordering actually you can probe by this technique, again is called resonant hard X-ray scattering. So here you use nickel KH, and there are certain reflections which are allowed in monoclinic phase but forbidden in orthorhombic phase. And if you do a nickel resonance energy scan, if you in the metal phase, you don't see in a signal, it's like a background. And as you are decreasing the temperature, you can see there are some features which is appearing. So this actually tells us that these systems has charge ordering. So we have used exactly same technique to probe our systems. So this is results for this one europium nickelate, one lanthanum nickelate, where I have already showed that they have a transition at 150 Kelvin. And these are the resonance scan at different temperature. You can see that up to 150 Kelvin, this resonance feature is very strong, very weak. But as soon as you go to the insulating phase, this resonance becomes very strong. I'll come back to this later. But the interesting thing is the other system. This, if you look at the 2-1 system, where you have a metal insulator transition at 245 Kelvin and nil temperature is 220 Kelvin, if you do this experiment at different temperature, you see that you can see the resonance, but that doesn't change with temperature. Yeah? So this tells us that this metal insulator transition doesn't accompanied by a charge ordering transitions, and the symmetry of this system is monoclinic throughout in both phases. Okay? So the symmetry doesn't change. So you are getting a MIT without this structural transition and charge ordering transition. So this MIT of this system can be accounted by this site selective mod transition. And as I told you that this D8 state, that is S equals to 1. So we have also done XMCD experiment and which confirms that this is actually S equals to 1. I will not go into the details, but if some of you are interested, we can talk more after the presentation. So basically in this case, it can be accounted by this site selective mod transition. And the most important thing is that now we can conclude that neither charge ordering, neither metal structural transitions is responsible for MIT. So this story is also very similar for VO2. In VO2 also, there are two transitions together, like metal to insulator and structure. So there are lots of debate also that what is the primary reason, whether it's a mod transition or not. So recently also by other group, so this is a group from Wisconsin Madison. So they have also done a similar heterostructure grown on VO2 and VO2 minus delta. From their experiment also they have found that you can have metal insulator transition in heterostructures without any charge ordering. So similar thing. So now coming back to this 1-1 sample. So this is the plot of the intensity of this resonance feature. You can see at 150 Kelvin you have a sudden jump, and this is this the intensity of this off resonance. So this resonance feature is a signature of charge ordering, and this off resonance, that is a signature of structure. So you can see there is also a transition. So it's basically a bond ordering transition and charge ordering transitions. Both are happening together, and below the transitions, both are increasing. That means they are actually cooperative in nature. Yeah, this case. So further, what we have done after this, now, so up to the previous slide, everything was due to interface. Now gradually we are increasing this layer number. So we want to introduce the bulk effect. So what we are doing, so this is like one unit cell of europium nickelate, one unit cell of lanthanum nickelate. So I am denoting by n equals to 1. Now I am growing first 2 unit cell of europium nickelate, then 2 unit cell of lanthanum nickelate, and repeating this thing. This is like n equals to 4 and this is like n equals to 8. So you can see that as you are growing along this direction, your bulk effects, europium nickelate, there are lots of layers which are behaving like bulk for both europium nickelate and lanthanum nickelate. So those bulk effects will also start to dominate. So apart from the interface, now you have a bulk also. Okay. So this, these are the transport data for this kind of samples. So this is the resistivity as a function of temperature. So n equals to 1, I have already described. So you can see that up to n equals to 5, all of the samples also exhibit a metal insulator transition, while the transition temperature doesn't change much. You see, they are very similar, but the resistivity value at the insulating phase, that is decreasing significantly. So we have also further done resonant soft X-ray scattering to probe the magnetism. I will not go into the details, but basically what we found that they are simultaneous, yeah, in all of this system, from n equals to 1 to n equals to 5. And you can see that when you are going to n equals to 8, yeah, so basically at that time the interface effect becomes unimportant. You can see that because when is n equals to 8, you have large several unit cell of lanthanum nickelate, and lanthanum nickelate is bulk. In bulk, it is a metal. Yeah, so that's why when you measure the resistivity of this kind of lattice, it just behaves like a metal. You don't see the interface. So now, in order to understand that, suppose for in this kind of system, how does the structure evolve, we have also done synchrotron X-ray diffraction experiment. So this is again this peak half-half-half, which is allowed for both monoclinic and orthorhombic, but is forbidden in the rhombohedral. Okay, and this is this 4 unit cell of europium nickelate, 4 unit cell of lanthanum nickelate. So what you see a substrate, you see a broad peak, and then you have lots of thickness fringes. So these thickness fringes comes because of the optical path of the X-ray are different in sample and your substrate. Yeah? You don't see any extra features. If you now do the same similar scan for another reflection, which is minus half half. So this minus half half is allowed for monoclinic, but is forbidden for orthorhombic and rhombohedral, both orthorhombic and rhombohedral. Now you can see that apart from your, this is your film peak, this is the thickness fringes. Now you can see some additional peak, yeah, which is known as super lattice peak. So why it is coming? So because from this what you can say that your europium nickelate is monoclinic, this lanthanum nickelate is orthorhombic. So that's why when you are doing this scan, X-ray doesn't distinguish this because both are allowed for both systems. But in this case, since it is monoclinic and this is orthorhombic, you have additional periodicity of 8. This is 4 unit cell, this is 4 unit cell. So you have additional periodicity of 8 unit cells, and that's why you are getting this extra super lattice peak. Actually, you can get this peak position, and if you add 1 by 8, you will get this one, the peak position. Okay. So from this, we can conclude basically that, and this is again, this measurement are done at room temperature. So at room temperature, where the system behaves like a metal, europium nickelate is in monoclinic phase and lanthanum nickelate is in orthorhombic phase. So again, we have done this resonant X-ray scattering experiment, but here you will see something different. If you plot this resonance intensity as a function of temperature, you see that across the metal insulator transition, it decreases. But if you look at the off-resonance intensity, it actually, below the metal insulator transition, it actually decreases. So in this system, this is a rare example where your bond disproportionation and charge disproportionation, they are actually competing with each other. So far there is no examples of such phase. So this is a new phase of the material, and it's coming purely because of this structural competition at the interface. There is nothing else. There is no charge transfer, nothing, just pure structure. Because of that, you can get this kind of very unusual phase. Okay. So we have done the same experiment. We want to make sure that what we are seeing is actually indeed true. So we have done the same experiment for other samples also, 5 europium nickelate, 5 lanthanum nickelate, and here also you can see that this off-resonance intensity is decreasing below the metal to insulator transition. Okay. So how much time I have? 2 minutes. Okay, good. So far I have talked about all of the super lattices are grown on this neodymium gallate substrate. So we have also checked what happens if you grow on a different substrate, basically if your strains are different. So these are the different substrate we have grown, the same system, 1-1. And you can see that when you are growing under compressive strength, this samples becomes completely metallic. There is no metal insulator transition. So in order to understand this metal insulator suppression of this insulating phase, we have also done oxygen KH X-ray absorption spectroscopy measurement. So this oxygen KH X-ray is actually a representation of oxygen P projected unoccupied density of states. Okay, it probes the level which is just above the Fermi level. And this is a pre-peak, which is in the literature is called as a pre-peak, and this is a signature of this D8 L-bar state. Okay, so the width of this pre-peak actually is a measure of hybridization of nickel D and oxygen P. If the peak is much broader, that means your hybridization is more, and if the peak is narrow, that means the hybridization is weaker. So this is this FWHM as a function of substrate lattice constant. You can see that as you are going to the compressive side, this peak is actually become much more broader. Yeah? So now in terms of Janin-Sawatzki-Allen phase diagram, so originally you are somewhere here, the parent compound, or like this on NGO here. So as you are huffing, but T is increasing, basically delta by T is decreasing. So you are basically moving, you are starting from here and then you are moving here. So that's why you are getting from a covalent insulator to a PD metal transition by strain. Okay. So I think my time is up. Okay. So let me conclude. So structural competition across the interface can lead to many emergent phases. And the other important conclusion is that this metal insulator transition is rare at nickelate, doesn't require any symmetry change or any charge ordering. And I hope I have been able to convince you that X-ray based techniques are very useful for microscopic understanding of such emergent phenomena. So let me conclude. Let me acknowledge all my. So this work was started when I was a postdoc in Jack Chakalian's group, and two of my students have also contributed in this work, and there are many scientists from different beam lines. So they are from Argonne National Lab, and Patrick, he is from Advanced Light Source, Berkeley, and Huyung Park, he also did some DMFT calculation on these systems, and the funding comes from IISc, DST Nanomission, and ACIB. Thank you.
Questions?
Yeah. Actually, yeah. Maybe I'll go back.
Removes metal insulator.
Yeah.
So that means superconductivity is not too far. It's a nominally a spin half system.
So we have done, we don't see superconductivity here.
Don't see, but.
Yeah. But recently, the system which shows superconductivity is strontium doped NdNiO2. So far.
It's a layered, yeah.
Yeah. So if you reduce this system, it will become O2, and then with strontium doping, it can become superconductive. So, like, this is a 2 months back report.
Short question.
Yeah.
You emphasized octahedral rotation.
Yeah.
But there are situations where there are octahedral compression, and here it doesn't happen.
So,
beginning.
Yeah. So, main thing is this rotation is controlling.
It's a major thing.
Yeah, because my strain is same for all the systems. Because my substrate is exactly same. But here it will affect. When I am changing the strain, that time this compression and elongation, those will also affect.
For the case of the transition, that metal insulator transition where you have no structure or charge order, just a pure metal insulator transition.
Yeah.
So from the data, like the resistivity data, do we know what type of, what type of transition this is? I mean, it's a continuous transition, but do we know what's the universality? I mean, just theoretical question.
While the structural symmetry remains same, it's monoclinic. But across the transition, there is a change in the lattice constant, very small, 0.2%.
So from the, I see.
So
see.
No symmetry change, but the lattice constant changes.
In case of rare earth nickelate phase diagram with temperature versus bond angle, so how we in the experimentally one control the bond angle?
So this phase diagram was obtained from bulk samples. Yeah. So in the bulk, you can synthesize different materials like lanthanum nickelate, neodymium nickelate. You can even also make alloy like Nd1-X, LaX, NiO3. Yeah. So you make the samples and then you do X-ray diffraction and refinement. From there, you can get the information about the bond angle. And then you measure magnetic property and transport. And then you know the transition temperature. And then you put the data. That's how this phase diagram has been obtained.
Okay. And one other question means in case of the BA2 thin film, when people observe the metal insulator transition, will it the transition temperature will change if you deposit BO2 on different substrate?
Yeah, that people have done already. Some other groups have done, and you can tune the temperature.
Any other questions? Can I quickly ask one?
Yeah, sure.
So when you were showing these resistivity traces in the metallic regime, I guess I don't know the carrier density. Can you tell us where the MIR limit is? Is there data far below that or?
Yeah, so these are actually bad metals. So if you heat these samples, so generally this thin film will not be stable at very high temperature. But there are some other work where from the optics measurement, but it was found that this conductivity or resistivity is actually crossing the MIR limit. It's a bad metal. Okay. So the other important thing which I didn't emphasize here, this resistivity in this range actually linear with temperature.
down to what temperature?
So this will be up to 150 Kelvin. It's very linear.
Any other questions? If not, let us thank the speaker one more time.